Sea of Red, it's time for another Fireside Chat, the official podcast of Flames fans. It's go time.
Well, the Calgary Flames somehow managed to pull out two wins in two games this week and show us again why, you know, maybe there's something here that we weren't expecting with this team this year. As always, I'm Dan alongside Matt. Matt, 2-0, you weren't expecting that. You were expecting the curse to continue on banner nights.
Yeah, well, I'm glad and grateful for the excellent cap off to Kipper's night against the Penguins. And they played well this week overall.
Well, if we go back to February 27th, the LA Kings were in town. They came to the Dome, and Sharangovich broke a tie in this one in the third. The Flames topped the Kings for their fourth straight win, a 4-2 win here at the Dome. Flames got goals from Mangiapane, Coleman, Sharangovich, and Backlund. Overall, what were your thoughts on this one?
Well, for the first half of the game, it was a very boring defensive game for both sides where nobody really did much of anything, frankly. Then the Kings opened the scoring. Calgary responded. Calgary scored again. Then the Kings tied it. And, you know, it became more interesting heading into the third period. But up until the Kings actually opening the scoring, it was a fairly boring game.
Yeah, that Philip Deneau goal seemed to just kind of crack things open.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I mean, I've been high on LA all year. They've been slipping lately. They changed their coach. I think they've still got some goaltending issues. But, you know, this was another game where I think we saw the Flames match up against a better team and showed that they can do this when they're against a better team if they want to.
Yeah, and frankly, LA is a team where if they had the goaltending, would probably be third or fourth in the West overall. And you know, the goaltending has tanked them to the point where they're in eighth.
We had Talbot, we had Riddick, neither one really worked out.
Yeah, exactly. And it's one of those where, you know, the Kings season's a bit on the line too, because they're not too far up on us for the last playoff spot. And, you know, like, their team is basically a decent goaltender away from actually being a legitimate threat in the West.
Yeah, no, and it's interesting to see how they're kind of falling quickly. Like, somehow they managed to get by with the goaltending they had, I'd say, until, you know, January 1st, sorry. And now they're tumbling quickly, and I think that's starting to catch up with them.
Well, and frankly, their team is built more for the playoff-style game because of how good and effective they are at shutting other teams down defensively. Like, they basically neutered the Flames until they opened the scoring, and then Calgary got a little more risky and, you know, some bounces went our way. But, you know, the Kings, like, if they make the playoffs, can be a dangerous team, but they need the goaltending to back up the excellent defense that they have.
Yeah, it's I'll be interested really to see what happens here with the Kings, sorry, and how far they fall or not. I think this is a team that we'll talk more about Markstrom a little bit later and goaltending, but I think that if there's a team out there looking for a goalie at the deadline, it's the Kings.
Yeah, like, I would not be surprised if either Saros or Markstrom was a King by the end of next week.
We will find out. And obviously then the Flames had a couple days off, and March 2nd rolled around, the big night, and Miikka Kiprusoff gets his banner raised to the rafters, eventually to be moved to the air vent. We won't get into this. This is still one of my biggest pet peeves, the Sal Dome, that the banners are not above the ice. They're to the side of the ice in the air vent. But great ceremony. I was there. You were there. I was there for the Jerome one. I think you were too. This was a really classy event. It was just like the Jerome one. It was really well done. I'm really proud of the Flames organization for how they handled it.
Yeah, and McLennan was the right amount of comedic relief that the evening needed. And, you know, everybody that spoke was good. And, yeah, it was a nice event all the way around.
Were you surprised to see Daryl Sutter?
No.
I was.
Yeah,
I
can understand.
After the way the things ended, I was kind of surprised to see him come back.
I can understand, but, you know, friendship and loyalty to people that, you know, you care about, you know, you kind of push, you know, any hard feelings you have with anything else. And it's not like the fan base necessarily was clamoring for Daryl to be fired. It was more so the players and the lack of results last year that did him in.
That's true. Well, let's talk about this game. Let's talk about the week, and then we'll swing back around to the Kipper stuff. How's that?
Yeah.
So the Flames end up winning 4-3. I think kind of an apt score here. 3-4, which is Kipper's number. This was an interesting game to be at. Like, for the first two periods, I think the Flames got 4 shots in the first period. They did not look good. They were not getting good shots. I don't think that the Penguins were looking all that good either, but the Penguins were getting better chances in the offensive zone. Like, the Flames were either just, and I wouldn't even say that Pittsburgh was moving them to the outside. The Flames were just sloppy in the offensive zone.
Yeah, and, you know, other than the one fluke play that allowed Sharon Govich to basically break in directly on Jari for the first goal for the Flames, like, they did not have a scoring chance in the first two periods at all.
No. And a lot of times it was, you know, either the Penguins doing taking the puck away in the offensive zone, or the Flames just not having a man for the second shot.
No, or they'd make passes to nowhere, and
yeah, that happened quite a few times.
Leading to turnovers, just generally sloppy and disinterested play from everybody. The only line that I thought actually was decent through the first two periods was the Peltier-Rooney line.
Yeah.
Because they seemed to be giving energy every time they were out there, even though their time on ice was rather sparse through the first 40.
It's funny. I mean, that is the energy line, isn't it?
Yep, well, they definitely helped, and then that hell of a Kadri goal in the third period.
The Kadri goal really opened things up. I mean, you know, great for, and we've talked a lot about Sharon Govich and, you know, the player he's becoming, but I think great for him. This is 2 games in a row that he's got the game winner, looking better and better every game.
Yeah, then frankly, that Kadri goal, I think, will probably be one of the top 5 goals all season for how nice of a play that was. And you know, it's like that play seemed to wake the team up of, hey, the Penguins actually suck, so why don't we actually try? Hey, yeah. You know, and then the Flames basically ran over them for the last 10 minutes of the game and skated to the win.
Yeah, and, you know, again, it showed that when these guys, you know, play their game, they can do this, but that's why they're a middling team, because they're horribly inconsistent at doing that.
No, and you can see that Pittsburgh is basically done as a playoff-caliber team.
Time to rebuild.
Yeah, like, their guys, even though, like, the skill is still there for the Crosbys, Malkins, and Letangs, like, the
Crosby
the legs,
did not look nearly as magical as he used to.
No, like, it you can tell the legs aren't there. And
yeah, I mean, he's 36 now, man.
Oh, I know, and there's no problem with that. It's just, you know, like, you expect a certain level of play from those kind of guys, and, like, they were severely lacking, I felt. You know, and the ageless wonder that is Jeff Carter managed to score a goal, which, you know, it's like,
when I saw his name, I'm like, huh, I didn't even know he was still around.
I know, I thought, you know, you get the feeling that he retired, like, 5 years ago, and, oh, hey, wait.
maybe he'll be the next Nirmer Jager.
Yep.
Never retire.
Well, and, you know, he wants to get up to 500. He's not that far away. So, you know, just got to keep chipping 10, 15 a year and you're good.
There you go. You mentioned that Kadri goal. And, you know, Kadri started the year not looking great. I think he's really come a long way since the beginning of the year and the way we've seen him develop. And that's weird to say as an older guy. I think he's got great line mates. But, you know, we weren't sure what to make of this $7 million deal for Kadri. I think we're getting our money's worth this year.
Oh, definitely. And to be fair, I thought we got close, if not our full value, last year, too.
I'd say close.
Yeah, and there's not really too much to complain about. Like, he's a high-end second-line center. He's playing like a high-end second-line center and borderline first-line center. And, you know, he's basically done all the things that he needed to thus far this season. And, you know, like, whereas a player like Lindholm was not actually hitting the mark on all of those things.
And I think interesting to see the struggles with Lindholm integrating into Vancouver as well.
Yeah. Well, and you're seeing the same thing with Zadorov, frankly, and both of those players were kind of malcontents here in terms of, like, not wanting to re-sign and all of that, or thinking that they were better than they were, and, you know, then get moved to a new team and basically both become Mr. Irrelevance on their team. And, you know, and it'll be interesting to see, especially like as the Flames move on from Tanev and Hanifin and possibly Markstrom, how those guys fare on their new teams as well.
Well, after these two games, the Flames are now on a 5-game winning streak. They've played 60 games. They have 30 wins, 25 losses, and 5 overtime losses for a total of 65 points.
That hey, we're at 500, actually.
542. Just yeah. over.
Well, for wins and losses, we got 30 wins and 30 losses.
That's true, so, yeah.
So, actual 500.
So, you're, the wins pretty much cancel out the losses.
Yep.
Right now, they are third in the wild card race at 65. St. Louis tied for them at 65, and Seattle at 63 right below them. But above the Flames at 72 is Nashville, and again, 72, the Los Angeles Kings. And Nashville has 2 games on us, and L.A. tied. So, you know, as much as the Flames are getting up there, still a long way to go.
Oh, there's no realistic way for the Flames to catch either of those two teams. 7 points in 22 games is very unlikely, and I don't care which team you're talking about, like making up that much difference, like you basically have to win like 15 of the 20 games and then hope the other team falls apart.
And in this Pittsburgh game, we really got to see the Flames defense post Chris Tanev, and it's not a defense that's going to win you that many games.
No, and like for as much as like Pichal and Gilbert have played well as a third pairing defenseman, like frankly they're going to get lit up, especially when Hanifin moves. That like there's no realistic way that this team has enough depth to be able to carry beyond.
We'll come back to that idea. I have something I want to ask you a little bit later, but let's go back to the Kiprusoff retirement speech. Interesting to see all of his colleagues there. That's the first time we've seen a lot of these 0-4 guys all together again. Like you said, Noodles, Jamie McLennan gave a fantastic speech. I love the part at the end where he said, I better stop talking or Daryl might pull me again. That was probably the line of the night.
Yeah.
Surprised that Jerome didn't talk, though. Like, of all those guys, Jerome's the talker. Maybe they knew that they needed to keep this thing on a on a timeline.
Yeah, well, I think that's part of the reason why they kept the amount of speakers limited, just because... You know, between the fantastic video tribute featuring Peter Marr.
And that was another thing I was going to say. I love that they brought Peter Marr in to do the video tribute.
You know, like, between those two things, like, it was absolutely fantastic. And
yeah. Peter Marr did his video tribute. We got to hear from Beasley one last time with his Miikka Kiprusoff call. The whole thing was really nostalgic. And, you know, I think that we could argue, you know, for a long time about the 0-4 team and what they meant to the Flames, but Matt, I want to put this by you. Two of the best Flames goalies now up in the rafters. We have Miikka Kiprusoff there. We have Mike Vernon. I'll give you my thoughts first. Who's the better of the two Flames goalies? And I have to go with Kiprusoff for two reasons. First off, Mike Vernon had a cast of all-stars in front of him. I don't think that, you know, he had to carry this team on his back as much as Kipper did. I think Kipper came in at a time when, you know, the Flames were, I mean, talking about leaving town and stuff like that. I think he single-handedly, in a lot of ways, saved this franchise, kept stability here, and he managed to take a ragtag group of guys in 04 all the way to the Cup, played 70 games for 7 seasons straight, and was probably the best goaltender of his time. Like, you know, he was never in front, he was never behind a really great team, and still managed to look like the best goalie in the league. Which one do you think?
I would have to agree with you on that. You know, in my mind, it's like comparing a guy like Ed Belfour to Patrick Waugh. Like, both top tier, top goalies, you know, ridiculously talented, but one guy's just a little bit better. And frankly, like, since Dominic Hasek and Patrick Waugh and Martin Brodeur were in the league, like, the only guy that I've felt that's been even close to those guys has been Kipper. And, like, even newer goalies like Carey Price and Andrei Vasilevsky, I've not felt were as dominant game in, game out, season in, season out. Even though they might have more Stanley Cups in Vasilevsky's case or more trophies in their case, for just pure talent, I think Kipper ranks right up there amongst the elite of the elite.
As we talked about last week, he may not make it to the Hall of Fame ever. He's in the Finnish Hall of Fame, but I don't know if he'll make it to the Hockey Hall of Fame. He's instead of just the Finnish Hockey Hall of Fame. But You know,
well,
I
considering
think,
the fact that his career basically was 10 years, the years that he played with Calgary, plus like a year and a half with San Jose, and you look at like all of the other goaltenders who are in the hall that have more wins than him in their career, like they played hundreds of games more than what Kiprusoff did, yeah. You know, and it, like he didn't really establish himself as a high quality NHLer until he was 27.
Well, that's it. He was traded here at 27. So we were kind of getting the back half of his career.
Yeah. And it's one of those where I could see the lack of games played not being held against him in the long term. Like, I don't see him getting elected to the Hall of Fame in the next 10 years, but I could see him eventually get in because, like, you look at, like, the best players of the aughts and, you know, like, 2010s, like, his name is, he was literally one of the top three goaltenders throughout that whole span.
And I think he will probably be the cornerstone for Flames goaltending for a long time. I mean, we still don't know what we have in Dustin Wolf, but Kipper's got some records that are going to be tough to beat. And as was mentioned a number of times last night during the ceremony, you'll probably never see a goalie play 70 games in a season again, much less 70 games in seven consecutive.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
You know, I mean, if you're playing your goalie that much in today's game, they're going to be done.
Yeah.
So really, really awesome to see. Really nice to see some of his teammates there, Rhett Warner. I was surprised Dion Phaneuf was back. Like, that's a guy that I wasn't sure kind of what the relationship with him and the Flames organization was.
Yeah, but he is also one of Kipper's best friends, so it does make a lot of sense.
And Glenn Cross, could see him, a whole bunch of people out there. It was awesome. His kids, his brother looked like he needed a comb before he went up there.
Yeah, well, yeah, and amusingly, it was his brother and his next-door neighbor, Saku Koivu, that made Kiprusoff the goalie he was, because they were both like 5 years older than Miikka was. And
that's usually how it works. The youngest kid becomes the goalie.
Yeah, hey, you know, you're old enough. You can go on the net. You're only four. Who cares? <That's> We're right. Just going to take slap shots on you. And
you wonder how often he took pleasure in beating Saku when they were in the league.
Oh, yeah. And his brother made the NHL, too, with the New York Islanders. So
he had a cup of coffee. He's like Gretzky's brother. He had a cup of coffee.
Yeah. Well, still, he made the NHL. So it does say a little bit of, you know, like, you have to be pretty good to make it there anyway. And
who do you think the next number to go into the rafters will be, Matt?
It's going to be a long, long time. I don't see anybody from the Gaudreau era getting retired at all or even honored.
I don't know. I guess it depends how we look at the Gaudreau era. I think that Giordano is going to get honored, but not retired.
Yeah, I could see that.
I think
that
Backlund will get honored. And I think we need, I mean, he's the long-term captain. He's one of the longest-serving Flames. For everything he's done in the community, I think that they will try to find some way to recognize him, whether that's Forever Flame or some new program.
Yeah, I don't see like either Giordano or Backlund deserving a jersey retirement. And yeah.
No, I don't think you should retire their jerseys. But and we've been critical about the Forever Flame program, you and I. I think they need something in the new building. Call it the Ring of Fire or something, where it's for players. Like, you know, I think Craig Conroy is a great example. He's done so much for this organization as a player, as manager, you know, in everything he's done, that he needs to be honored. But you don't want to, you know, retire his number. And maybe they need a secondary level that is sort of like that. What about a guy like Daryl Sutter? I think there needs to be some recognition for Daryl Sutter, for Badger Bob. You're not going to retire them, but there needs to be, I think, something.
And it's sort of
Forever
like
Flames, not quite that.
Yeah, and to bring it to baseball again, like the Toronto Blue Jays have what's called the level of excellence, where like they have like their best of the best without retired jerseys on like a whole level of their building, you know, as a tribute to, you know, and each section has like their own guy. And, you know, like it, that,
well,
that
even in
something
hockey,
along
the
that
Canadian way, have their own Hall of Fame. And that'd be kind of cool if there was a physical Calgary Flames Hall of Fame.
Yeah. And you could even attach that to the building even.
Yeah. Make it free to get into, so you don't need to come to the game. Cause right now all the Hall of Fames is kind of just exhibit and displays around the dome. But I think that there's a need for a second level there. But, you know, as far as the next number, I think Theo blew his chance. I think he had a chance in 2009 when they brought him back for training camp. I think that was the organization's way of bringing him in, cutting him, you know, letting him go, having a great story and retiring him. And he kind of messed that one up.
Yeah, I agree. And I the only way I could see his number getting retired by the Flames is posthumously.
Yeah, as sad as that would be.
Yeah.
Because, you know, even like last night, they brought out all the other guys on stage, and I don't know that right now they want Theo Fleury being that face of the organization or face of the alumni. So you're right. I think that might be what it takes. And if Goudreau would have re-signed here for 8 years, I think you could make up that banner right now.
Oh, yeah. And he kind of blew that, too. Like, he could have wrote his ticket as, you know, like that iteration's a Ginla, but now he's Mr. Irrelevant in Columbus. And
we could have carved the statue to put outside the new building already.
Yep. And hey, we would have saved a lot on LeBron, so.
There you go. You only need half of it. Well, Matt, let's talk about the big trade this week. Chris Tanev traded between the LA and Pittsburgh game. We knew this was coming. We didn't quite know where. We didn't quite know what the return would be, but weird three-way deal here. The Calgary Flames get Artyom Grushnikov, a 2024 second-round pick, a conditional third-rounder, which is only if Dallas goes to the Stanley Cup final this year, and Calgary retains 50% of the Tanev deal. Dallas gets Chris Tanev at 75% retained, and New Jersey prospect Cole Brady, and New Jersey gets Dallas's fourth rounder, and they eat 25% of the contract. So if you're Dallas and you can get Chris Tanev for less than $2 million, great deal.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, it was nice to see the Flames utilizing a broker in this deal and not having to, you know, like add additional things to make it work. Like,
yeah, and who knows,
you know,
the Flames that use the broker, or Dallas?
Well, in terms of like not having to take a guy on. Just for,
yeah, okay. I thought maybe it meant like, you know, they probably wanted Calgary to retain 75 and we found a broker.
Yeah. More that like didn't need to eat a contract.
Yeah.
You know, like taking a suitor back or something like that.
There was a lot of talk that Tanev should get a first in return. What do you think about the return?
I actually was one of the few people that actually knew about Grushnikov before the trade happened, and I actually really liked him.
I think everybody who's been going to Texas Stars games know about him, but sure.
Well, no, back when he was drafted, he was one of the players that I was looking at for the Flames to select. So, and he's a very tough, rugged defensive defenseman that likes to hit, and he can skate. If you're a defensive defenseman, like, I know a lot of people have been harping on, oh, well, he doesn't put up points. Well, he's big, he skates, and he hits everything that moves. I think you're pretty much going to guarantee that guy is going to be an NHL defenseman as long as he's okay defensively, and he's actually very composed defensively. So I feel that the Flames basically replaced Tanev with the Tanev-type guy. Might not be like as much with the block shots, but certainly the physicality is going to be right there. And being 6'2", 210, you know, like, that's not going to be fun for other teams' players to have to face night in, night out.
And Conroy said, if you just look at the stats line, you're not necessarily going to understand this guy because he's not getting a ton of stats. He's not an offensive guy, but he is that sort of, you know, that stay-at-home defenseman, that big, rugged defenseman. I think he's a good return. I just want to, you know, give some of my thoughts here. You were not going to get a top prospect for a rental, especially a rental that, you know, has played, let's be honest, 70 games once. Like, you don't know if Chris Tanev's going to make it to the playoffs or not.
No. And realistically, like, the Flames could have probably got a late first. And, like, there have been rumors that, like, Toronto wanted to dump Reeves on us as well as their first for Tanev. And, frankly, for how good of a player Grushnikov is, that getting a second, you know, it's a matter of like 20 picks difference. Mm-hmm. But the Flames scouting staff is fairly good. And, you know, like, you look at like our second round pick last year, Etienne Morin, like, you know, if the Flames get another high quality guy like that, and there's always fallers and that are like borderline first round pick type guys that fall to that area, like, the Flames could get another top end prospect that wouldn't have been out of line taking with a first round pick, and getting a guy that's looking like he's pretty much of a guaranteed NHL player as you can get from a prospect.
Yeah, I think it's good. And, you know, I mean, we've seen Craig kind of go out and get some of these under-the-radar guys, whether it was, you know, something as simple as getting Nigor Sharangovich or this trade. I think
even acquiring Pashal off waivers. Like, yeah. He's an NHL
and
defenseman.
And A.J. Greer.
Yeah. And,
you know, he's hurt right now, but we had nothing but complimentary things to say about A.J. Greer when he was in the lineup.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, like, this is kind of how you are more effective at retooling on the fly and rebuilding on the fly, that you don't go into like the 10-year wilderness that, you know, the Buffaloes and Edmontons and Arizonas had to go into, because like you're getting guys that look like high quality prospects or, you know, borderline NHL or ready players, or literally NHL ready players, that you can just slot into your lineup, if not this year, next year. And, you know, also balancing out your prospect pool, because like the Flames having Brustevich, Morin, and Poirier, who are all very good offensive defensemen, you know, balancing that out with a guy like Grushnikov and Kuznetsov, like now you've got kind of your set trio of good offensive defensemen.
You own Yermo too, and I don't know what to expect there, but we can't forget him.
Well, and Yermo's in that same defensive style, and same like with Soloviev and a few others, where, you know, you have like your defense prospects and your offensive D prospects, but now like the Flames actually have a handful of each, which, you know, like you gotta figure that like half to two thirds are not gonna pan out. But, you know, if you're getting enough of each type, you will actually end up getting guys that you can fit into your lineup long term. And, you know, it's a very good way to, you know, instead of like having to spend 4 or 5 years of draft picks and then waiting 3 or 4 more years, you know.
Yeah. And I think the first will come. Like, I would be surprised if they don't get a first plus something for Hanifin.
Yeah.
So right now, the Calgary Flames have 9 picks in 2024 in this draft. They have 2 firsts, Calgary's and Vancouver's, 2 seconds, Calgary's and Dallas's, a third, a fourth either New Jersey or Vancouver from the Lindholm deal, a fifth from either Chicago's or Calgary's, and a sixth. So they've got picks all through the lineup right now, which is nice, or all through the draft, I should say, which is nice, because how often have we gone in without, you know, having a round? Right now, the only round we're not in, I think, is third and seventh. Which is, you know,
yeah, just the seventh round.
Yeah, I'll take it, especially if we, oh no, we do have a third. So yeah, no seventh. So I'll take that. And, you know, I think here, I was, the only part of this I'm surprised about is the third. Like, you know, yes, the third is if they go to the Stanley Cup Finals. First off, I was kind of expecting the condition to be tied to Tanev's performance. Like Tanev plays 10 playoff games or something. And secondly, I'm surprised that it goes away entirely. I kind of thought it'd be like a fifth, and then they make the Stanley Cup Finals a third.
Yeah, well, I think that's just direct compensation for the second round pick devaluing, you know, because like realistically, like the second round pick should be around pick 50, give or take. But, you know, if it goes to like 64 type or 63, you know, like that's worth a third round pick for that difference.
Yeah, that's, you know, a good way to look at it.
And it's one of those where, you know, it's just a protection for that, because just in case Dallas, you know, because Dallas has basically all the parts themselves to be a cup team. So, you know, it just depends on their matchups, frankly.
Yeah, yeah, I think Dallas can beat anyone in the Pacific.
Yeah, and they could probably beat, the only team that I think they'd have a hard time with is Colorado. But mind you, I feel that you could say that literally of every other playoff team. So, because, you know, like, frankly, it looks like it's going to be Colorado's cup final to lose type of thing. Because, like, they're looking fairly similar to how they were a couple of years ago when they won.
And Dallas's draft year really looks like the draft year of a team that's going all in. They have a first, a fifth, and a seventh. Like, they're mortgaging this draft for the immediate future, which you see all the time, right? You see that anytime you've got a team that thinks they're in it. I mean, you know, and I wouldn't be surprised if that's by like the end of the week, they don't have that fifth and seventh.
Yeah, well, or the first even. And, you know, like I can understand. It's sort of like when the Flames went and got Toffoli and Yarncroke. Yeah, they perhaps overpaid slightly for the two of them combined. But, you know, it made sense. The Flames were an elite team. Go get a good third line player and a good first line player. And it didn't work out for us that season, but you know, you have to go in when you're in that zone.
Yep.
And yeah, and it didn't pan out, and then yeah, you move on, but you know, that's a different story.
And Grushnikov has played 2 games this weekend for the Wranglers. He's wearing number 2 there. It looks like he doesn't have a point this weekend, but if you're interested in seeing this asset the Flames got back, head down to the Dome, watch the Wranglers play.
Yeah, and for those that have watched the 2 games, everybody has basically said that he's a very composed defensive defenseman that skates well. And
overall, thumbs up or thumbs down on the deal?
2 thumbs up. I
agree.
You know, like, outside of, like, getting, like, a center prospect for instead of Grushnikov, you know, like, at least Grushnikov, he basically looks like an NHL player out of the box. Like, you know, it's, like, his skating is up there with, like, the Oliver Shillingtons of the world, not, you know, like, your standard defensive defenseman who's kind of the slow lumbering guy. Like, he's a very quick defenseman. It's just, you know, basically him getting more experience before he's up here. And I wouldn't even be shocked if he doesn't necessarily get a recall late in the season just to give him a game or two at the end.
Well, it depends on how things go this week, and we'll get back to this. Flames may need a defenseman.
Yep.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think thumbs up. Yes, the Flames were looking for a first. The fact they already have a first, and I think they'll probably end up with another first later this week, I'm not too worried. I think what they got is fine. I think it's a good return. And I found it interesting that in his exit interview, Tanev kind of left the door open for coming back to Calgary in the offseason.
Well, and how did you say? Calgary is a really nice place to live and play. You know, like, Kadri loves it here. And, it, you know, it's one of those where... would I be happy having him back? Sure. The Flames are going to have a ton of cap space in the offseason, and they're going to need defensemen anyway, so it would make sense if we brought him back, and, you know, I definitely would not be against that at all.
Yeah, on the right deal, for sure.
Yeah, like, I would be expecting, like, a 2 or 3 year deal.
I'd be expecting a 1 year.
At, like, 3, 3, 5, 4.
You know, yeah, I think, like, he's not going to make more than he has now. He's 34, and there's cap implications after 35 for him, so I think you start getting 1 year deals with this guy.
Yeah, and that's where I could see, like, you know, the Flames possibly getting him for a little bit longer at, like, 2 or 3 years at a slightly reduced cap hit. But maybe. Yeah, I think that there's going to probably be about 30 teams wanting to sign Tanev on July 1st, so, you know, that ball is definitely in his court 1,000%.
We'll see where he ends up. But another player we should talk about when it comes to trade stuff is Jacob Markstrom. Markstrom, as we have, I think, talked about in the past, there's been some rumblings of him maybe going to New Jersey. There's a rumor that New Jersey had a package with Holtz and a first coming back to Calgary. Calgary is all in on it. And then they even went to Markstrom to get his approval because he has a full no move. And it fell apart with salary retention. Now there's some rumors that New Jersey is willing to do without the salary protection, or the salary retention, sorry. Markstrom was asked about this week by Eric Francis, and here's his quote. "Everyone in here, I really expect everything that has been, I really respect everything that's been going on and not going on, how everyone in the room has handled everything. And then the whole situation and everything, am I happy about it? No, I'm not. I think it could have been handled a lot differently from up top." So reading into that, we're not sure what up top means. Maybe he doesn't like the way the GM's doing things. Maybe he doesn't like the way the broadcast's doing things. Maybe he just doesn't like the look of the people on the press level. Or maybe it's, you know, someone with management, with Murray Edwards. We're not quite sure how up top this comment goes, but how do you take that?
Well, frankly, it seemed that, like, because the Flames were so close and, like, things started to leak out about the deal, you know, and now there's chatter that, like, the Flames are wanting to keep him through this season, which I think would be perhaps the stupidest decision that this team's made in 20 years. But, you know, it's one of those where, you know, this team needs to get it done. And, you know, like, every day that, like, Hanifin and Markstrom are a part of this team, you know, like, it's a distraction for everybody else, and it just needs to happen. And, you know, it's tough because nobody likes getting traded or situations like this, especially when you have term on your deal. But, you know, like, for the Flames situation, like, it just, like, there are certain things that just need to happen, and this is one of them.
I can see here, while I was being a little facetious about the broadcasters and the press level people, I have a feeling this comes down to management and maybe ownership. I think that he may not be happy with the sort of retool direction. I don't know if I'd want to be part of that if I was a 34-year-old goalie. I also think that, you know, the fact the Flames came to him and asked him, hey, would you be okay with this deal? Or allegedly came to him and asked him. I have to imagine you start to prepare for a move then. You know, he's probably maybe calling the wife, talking about moving, and all of a sudden, oh, just kidding, you're not moving. That I can see him not being very comfortable with.
No, you're yanking his chain a bit.
Exactly.
And, you know, and that's not
And if cool salary retention was part of the deal, it should have been figured out before you went to the goaltender.
No, and it, like, it's really hard to keep playing for the team that's jerking you around like that. And, like, while he has been exceptional this week, and every game he's played since all of this, it's very difficult for him to proceed normally. And you know, and going back to my comment of, like, this would be really stupid of the Flames to keep him, you know, it's mainly due to the fact that he's 34 and the Flames are not realistically close to a playoff spot. They're 7 points out, and the Flames have Vladar and Wolf that are basically ready to be starter and backup, and Markstrom is literally in their way, which, that's not a problem, but it's also a problem. And
it's a good problem to have.
Yeah. And if Markstrom was 32, there's absolutely no way you would trade him.
No.
You know, you just eat the 2 years that, you know, and then hope to re-sign him after that. And, you know, as the Flames build back up. But when he's 34 now, like, by the time the Flames are competitive again, he's going to be 36 or 37. And, you know,
there's very few goalies that get better with age. Tim Thomas comes to mind.
Yeah, and even if he just stands pat and is basically his career average, that's well and good, but that's not great either. And
we also have to remember that he's a very streaky goalie. Last year he looked terrible. The year before he looked okay. The year before that he didn't look great. Like, we seem to get him good on every second year.
Yeah, and this is, like, the single perfect opportunity. There's no other goaltenders in the market because UC Saros, being the only other guy, is ridiculously overpriced for what he brings for all the other goaltenders that are available. And, you know, like, it's basically you're getting 3 years of playoffs with Markstrom if you're the other team. So, like,
Aaron's hot.
Yeah, like, it's one of those, like, you're saving the money, frankly. Like,
I mean,
even if you have
to strike while the iron's hot, my bad.
Yeah, well, it's like you're getting, like, even if you have to eat Vanacek's contract for the next 2 years at $3 million each.
I think you could find a team to take him without eating anything.
Yeah. Well, even, like, if you did have to take a contract back, like, you could easily flip Vanacek later. You know,
yeah, I think, like, you'd want to do something like the like the deal they got back from Vancouver, where, you know what, it's still an NHL player who is good enough, Kuzmenko, and you can keep on your roster if you can't flip him.
Yep, and, you know, you could run Vladar Vanacek for, you know, the balance of this year, and then look in the offseason for moving one of the two guys and bring Wolf up for next year.
Yeah, and I think we've talked that I think if the Flames do move a goaltender, they're going to need to take some goalie back.
Yeah, and realistically, like, there's just no part of any of this where there's any sense to keeping Markstrom. You know, like, it would be different if we didn't have Wolf in the system and we didn't have Vladar playing as good as Vladar's played. You know, like, this team needs to actually just punt this season. It sucks, and, you know, especially when you're ninth, but, like, the biggest fail for this team would be if they're picking between picks 12 and 16 again. You know, like, they need to fall back into the top 10, and, you know, they're not far above being a top 10 pick team, but they need to get one of those top 10 picks. And, you know, like, you're just basically screwing yourself out of a good player if you're not picking that high, and, you know, like, as the rumors say, like, with getting Holtz back for Markstrom, like, Holtz was the 7th overall pick a couple of years ago, and he's looking like he could be a top line forward. Well, you know, like, the Flames need to get guys that have that potential in their system, and, you know, it's hard when, you know, like, if you're picking 14th, 15th, like, you can get those guys like Thomas Chabot in Ottawa, for example, or Matt Barzal in the Islanders, but it's very hard to actually hit those, and you can easily get, you know, miscellaneous guy that never plays a game, or, you know, you try him out for a bit and he sucks.
Based on the comments, do you think that the relationship between Markstrom and the Flames is starting to sour?
Oh, I think it's already done, frankly. I would be absolutely floored if Markstrom was starting for us next year if we keep him through the deadline. But I just think that it would be beyond idiotic for this team. Like, how would you say?
I think this year, more than other years, you've got the hottest goalie in the league, and you've got teams I think will pay an arm and a leg for that hot goalie.
Yeah, and realistically, like, the Flames are the 11th worst team in the NHL right now. That is with the best goalie in the NHL playing on God mode, and you're still the 11th worst team in the league. Like, give it up. You know, like, there's no realistic way that that's going to help you other than submarining your own draft pick. Basically, just because, oh, well, we got a good goaltender. Well, that doesn't help you right now. And, like, that's the kind of namby-pamby half-measure BS that caused, like, the Flames to lose out on trading Jerome well after his time, holding out until Kipper's basically retired, and Bollmeister was long in the tooth. And, you know, like, the Flames rebuild should have started in 2010, and instead it took till 2013 for it to actually kick off, and, you know, like, it was a lot harder for this team to actually bounce back from that. And, you know, they got lucky basically finding Gaudreau. If they didn't do that, like, they'd probably just have been coming out of their rebuild, like, last 2 or 3 years. It's just frustrating because, you know, like, this team, it seems like they're just trying to go for the playoff revenue, which doesn't actually matter.
We've talked a lot about that. Let's wait and see what happens this week leading up to the deadline before we get too frustrated.
Oh, I know. It's just, you know, I get annoyed when it's like there are obvious things that you should do as a team. And, like, when you're not doing those obvious things, that it's like, but why? You know, and this is one of those, like, why would you keep Markstrom? Like, it, as good as, you know, like, this is no critique on Markstrom. He's been absolutely God mode for the team this year. And he should go have an opportunity to go win a cup with some other team. And, you know, because we're not going to make the playoffs and we're not going to do anything even if we get there. So, you know, just wasting his time as much as ours.
We've talked a lot about the trade deadline. You're talking about Markstrom here. I want to wait and see what happens. We know Hanifin's going to leave sometime between now and then. Outside of those guys, anything else you're expecting for the trade deadline? I'm expecting that the Flames are going to have to bring back a defenseman. And we saw Treliving do this, you know, every year, it seems, bring in a depth defenseman, whether it was, Erik Gustafsson or even last year with Troy Stetcher. I don't think they have the horses to call someone up right now from the Wranglers. I think they're going to need to find some team's number seven.
Yeah, frankly, I would expect that, like, in the Hanifin trade, part of that will be, like, their number six or seven guy. In exchange for, or, you know, some sort of, like, three-way trade or some permutation where,
yeah,
like,
or even getting grabbing a guy on waivers that's been placed on there because somebody else found their man.
Yeah, like, any of those.
But things. I think, however, like, it happens, you will see an NHL defenseman coming back to Calgary. That's the only NHL-ready player I'm expecting to come back, unless a big deal like the Holtz deal.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, if the Flames get Holtz, then great. As for other Flames moves, I wouldn't be surprised if Kevin Rooney's moved, just because he's playing adequately as a fourth line center, and if you can get, like, a fifth or a sixth round pick for him, I think that's more beneficial to the team than even though he's been good, like, the Flames can throw insert miscellaneous prospect in there and, you know, go from there.
I mean, going through lineup, you can't trade Pekal. Nobody wants Gilbert. You're not trading Anderson. You're not trading Shillington. You're not trading Uyghur. So, you know, you need a defenseman there. I don't think you're making a trade for Kuzmenko. You don't want to move Peltier. I don't think Dryden Hunt moves. Sharon Govich doesn't move. Huberto's not moving. Good luck moving that. Postel doesn't move. Kadri doesn't move. Zari doesn't move. Mangiapane, I don't think, moves. Backlund doesn't move.
Yeah, Coleman, like, Mangiapane and maybe Coleman would be the only two guys that I could see possibly moving. But even then, the likelihood is, like, virtually zero. And I think that you'd have to eat half of each contract.
I think if you're
going to
move one of those two, you'd be doing it in the offseason.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, if anything, I think that, like, you'd see, like, Mangiapane with Kuzmenko at next year's trade deadline getting moved and, like, that being, like, the next phase of things.
Yeah, and Coleman has a no-trade clause. I don't know if he wants to go anywhere right now.
True. And it's one of those where, you know, like, with all permutations, like, unless the player is specifically asking for it, like, that's why I threw Coleman out there.
I think if I was one of those guys, I'd want to wait and see how this one ends.
Yeah. Like, I could see Coleman, like, if he really wants to go to a cup contender, that the Flames would allow that. But, you know, that would be literally asking for a trade and then making it work. And
yeah, even in that case, I think if I was the Flames, unless he really needed it this year, I'd try to wait until the offseason.
Yeah, I agree. It'll be interesting to see, though, how exactly they break things down. But I think that, like, outside of Rooney and maybe Mangiapane, potentially, I don't see, like, the Flames moving out anybody else
and
other than
Hanifin,
Markstrom.
Like, you know, we'll talk about him in a minute here. We have a fan question about him. He's been good on that position, but I don't know how much trade value there is. I think most teams have a Kevin Rooney.
Well, depth fourth line centers are always useful. Like, even like, if the guy only basically becomes the playoff team's, like, 13th forward, he's a in case of emergency break glass kind of guy, because he's a good defensive center, which, you know, if you do run into injury troubles and you're missing a center, that's, like, the hardest thing to backfill. So that's where I could see, like, if he was a winger, I would not expect him to get moved. But him being a center, I could see it.
Well, we had a question this week from user at Fear the Flaming Sea on Twitter. That was a bit of a mouthful for me. He goes by the name Dime, at Fear the Flaming Sea, and he asks us, why don't we discuss Kevin Rooney and how he's fit nicely into the fourth center role as well as on the PK? Heck, even Hunt has been a welcome surprise. You've talked a little bit about Rooney there. I mean, I thought Rooney was going to be a great add for the Flames last year, and boy, did I get burned by that in our prediction game. He spent most of the year in the AHL. But,
well,
you know,
it took a year and a half and injuries and all of that for him to figure out how to be a really good fourth line center. And,
well, and he figured this out in New York. Like, he looked good there. I'm not quite sure why he wasn't up last year.
Yeah.
I think he started the season not looking good, and they sent him down, and maybe just needed some polishing. But, yeah, I think he's looked great. I mean, you know, I think the Flames would be happy to bring him back. I know this was very much a Brad Treliving signing. I don't know what Conroy's thoughts are there, but I'd be happy if they wanted to bring him back. You don't really have a centerman in the American League that's really pushing for that spot, so I'd be okay to bring Rooney back for a year.
No, and frankly, you look at the Flames organizationally, like, their main two operations this offseason are going to be acquire a center and acquire a defenseman, whether that's through trade or free agency, to kind of reset the team a bit. And, you know, especially with them having a boatload of cap this offseason, like, I would not be surprised if they go and sign a second, third line caliber center and a second, third line or a second, third pairing defenseman in the, like, Chris Tanev mode, and, you know, go from there.
I mean, you know, Rooney is 30 years old, so he's not a young guy. He's been playing in the NHL since 2016, 2017. He's been around the league for a while, and he's had a lot of NHL experience. I think just being an older guy there, we're starting to see some of that wisdom and maturity come through and, you know, seeing what we need there from a fourth line player. And I think maybe part of the problem in the past was he didn't really have that identity. He was a big kid, or a big guy, but we didn't really know what he is. Now I think he's he's on the fourth line that in the past was more of a banging fourth line. You know, they tried to put him in with Lucic and things like that last year, which isn't where he belongs. And I think having a different identity on the fourth line, he's with last game, he was with Peltier and Kuzmenko. That's a very different fourth line. I think
he's
almost he's playing
more
the
of
Derek
like a,
Ryan style.
I was
of,
literally just about to say, reminds me a lot of what Derek Ryan brought to the team. So, yeah.
And I think he can do that very well.
Yeah, and like I wouldn't be opposed to having him back. It's just one of those where, you know, like if you can get an asset for him and then revisit in the offseason, I could see that too.
And then Dime here on Twitter also asked about Dryden Hunt, a player the Flames brought in late last year. And I think that was part of the Stone, the deal that they sent with Troy Stetcher, if I remember correctly.
It was Zahorna.
Oh, okay, that's right.
To Toronto for Hunt.
That's right. Another guy that we've forgotten about was Zahorna. I knew it was a late season deal. He looked good last year in the AHL. He's looked good this year. He's fit in really well in the NHL. And even last night, we saw him playing that Pittsburgh game with Sharon Govich and Huberto for a lot of the night. Like, you can tell, again, this is a guy who's been around professional hockey for a while.
Yeah, definitely a plug-and-play kind of guy. Is he a long-term solution to any of your roles on the team? No. But he can fill in a top-six role or a bottom-six role and play okay and not look like completely in over his head. He's just serviceable. And
I mean, he's been in the NHL since 17-18. He's played for Florida, Arizona, the Rangers, Colorado, Toronto, Calgary. So he's played on successful teams, played on not-so-successful teams. I think this would be a great guy to be the 13th forward next season.
Oh, yeah. He, I would expect to be back for sure because he's from here, especially. Yeah.
And, you know, at 28, you know he's not developing anymore in the American League.
No. He's just your prototypical filler guy on a semi-rebuilding team.
And, you know, we don't know how long, you know, I was going to say he could be like the Michael Stone of the forwards, but we don't know if he can be ready after not playing for 6 months. But if he can be that guy that you can put in almost anywhere in the lineup and he can be adequate, that's a very valuable thing from your number 13.
Yep.
So, yeah, I think both those guys deserve some kudos here. Dryden Hunt, number 15, Kevin Rooney, number 21. Who knows what will happen long term? Who knows if, you know, Rooney will want to be back or where they go? But I think, you know, this has been one of the stories of the Flames this year, is being able to find this depth and bring these guys in and, you know, not see. I mean, even a guy like Postol, who I don't think anybody expect to be in the NHL this year, you know, fitting in there well. I think that's been really the story, is how well some of these guys are just coming in, integrating into the role they're given.
Well, and there was a bizarre stat that I heard the other day that with the Flames having Postol in the lineup, we're actually playing better than the Colorado Avalanche this year. And it's literally him not being in the lineup that's submarined this team. Like, that's just how much of a difference he's made into the game by just being the disturber. And
makes
you know,
sense.
You know, and it's always good when you have a Michael Ferland type guy that just is a pain to play against. And like we saw him getting pushed and punched a few times in the Pittsburgh game. And, you know, he definitely gets under everybody's skin.
Sure does. Matt, I think that comes to the end of talking about the Flames for this week. Anything else you want to cover?
No, just looking forward to seeing how things go between now and the trade deadline. And looking forward to talking with you next week about new people, hopefully. And, you know, draft picks and whatnot. And
new people and a lack of current people?
Yes.
I think we can both agree that at least Hanifin's getting moved.
Oh, I would be floored if he, like, it's, unless for some reason he changes his mind and signs a contract with us, which I think is hovering around 0%. Like,
I think it looks bad if they come out at the last minute and say, oh, by the way, now he decided to stay.
Yeah, well, and it's one of those where I'm sure that him and his agent are basically talking with all of the relevant teams. And, you know, like, this is what we're looking for. Will you sign that?
If
and
the Flames can either sign and trade or trade him to a place where he knows he wants to sign, I think they're going to get a lot
more thing
money.
Is that if he has the contract signed before the trade deadline itself, he gets the 8 years with whomever his new team is. It's 7 years after the deadline. So that's where, like, you know, that comes into play. And So that's where, like, I'm sure
it's 8 years up to July 1st, isn't it?
No, it's the trade deadline.
The Flames were able to sign Tkachuk to the eight, right?
Yeah, because he was our guy. Okay. It has to, the guy has to be playing on your team before the trade deadline for you to sign the eight.
I see.
And that's why that was a sign and trade, not just a here, take him.
Yeah.
And you sign him. That was the reason, because we had the leverage on that one. And yeah.
Well, the Flames have four games this week, two more before the deadline. They have one more game on this homestand Monday night against the Seattle Kraken, 7:30 start time at the Dome. Then they have a couple nights off where they'll start a three-game road trip. The first one is Thursday the 7th, the day before the trade deadline, 5 p.m. start in Tampa Bay. Then they do not play on deadline day. Saturday, the day after the deadline, the 9th, they'll play a 2 p.m. game in Florida against the Panthers. And the next night on a back-to-back of 3 p.m. start time against the Carolina Hurricanes. So four games this week. Last week I did well. You predicted all losses. I predicted all wins. I won. I'm 2-0 this week, just like the Flames.
What are your predictions? I'm going to go 1-3. I think they beat Seattle and then lose all three on the road.
Wow. Okay. Do you think that Hanifin gets moved before that Tampa Bay game?
I would be shocked if he was on the team on the road trip at all. And I would not be surprised if he gets dealt it tomorrow morning or later after we're done our show.
It seems kind of, I don't know, it seems like kind of a dick move to take him on the road for a day just to trade him on the road.
Yeah, unless you're like trading him literally to the team that you're going to play next. Because the Flames technically play the Tampa one day and then Florida the
day
after.
And both those teams have talked about being in on it. Do you take future considerations for the transport of getting them there?
No, it's literally do what Florida did with their coach. Just drop them at the airport, say, yeah, you get home.
Didn't they just leave the coach on this out of the bus, not even at the airport? Didn't they
just
leave him
outside
the rink?
Yeah. Here, bye.
There you
go. You're not with us anymore. It's
and if they're
problem.
Already midair, grab a parachute. Get out.
Yep. Have fun. Bye.
Open the door.
Yep.
And throw him out and then have Depot just throw sticks out one at a time. All right, get off the plane, kid.
Yep. Not our problem.
That's right.
Bye.
I think that the Seattle game will be the last game you see Hanifin as a Flame. I think, like you said, they will either not take him.
And honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if the Flames decide to hold him out for that game.
Yeah, I think we may have seen his last game already. But if not, I think it'll be that Seattle game. Even if they haven't traded him, I don't think they'll take him on the trip. I think they'll leave him behind and have him not play in Tampa, even if he is still a Flame.
Yeah.
Just that he stays home and he's, you know, he's here when the trade happens. I'm trying to figure out what I think this week. The Flames tend to play up to good teams, play down to bad teams. By that logic, we should probably see a win against Tampa Bay. We should probably see a win against Carolina. But Carolina is also a back-to-back and a matinee, two things that the Flames are terrible at.
So you know what's going to happen. We're going to sweep the week, and everything's just going to be utterly confusing for no reason.
If they sweep the week, and they're already, what, 5 wins in a row?
Yeah.
9 wins in a row? That's going to be the longest win streak they've had in a long time.
Well, they had a 10-gamer a couple of years ago when they won the division.
I don't think you can sweep the week with Tanev and Hanifin not on your back end.
No. That's why I was going 1-3 myself, just because, you know, I'm expecting Hanifin to be gone before the Tampa game at least. So, you know, it's going to be hard for this team to do a lot.
Yeah, and I'm just looking ahead here. Like, I think you'll see some significant changes on our opponents, but I think, I mean, they're all good teams. None of them are really going to be sellers here.
Yeah.
I'm going to say they win against Seattle, and I'm going to say that they win against Carolina. I think that Carolina might have enough change that it takes a couple days for them to sort of figure things out after the deadline. And I think they'll lose to Tampa Bay and they'll lose to Florida. So I'm going to go 2-2 this week.
Yeah. I will say that the Florida game will be a 6-4 or 6-5 final, because that just seems to be how we play with them every game. You know, going over the last handful of years, it always seems to be like 5-4, 6-5, 6-4, that kind of stupidity. So,
yeah. No, I think that one could definitely be a high scoring game. I think that the Carolina game could be high scoring too.
Yeah.
Like, while I think the Flames will win that one, I think they'll barely eke out a win.
Yeah.
So, Matt, pending that Markstrom is not traded, where do you put Vladar in?
Vladar should probably play against Seattle and one of the matinee games. I'd probably put him in against Carolina.
Yeah, I think Carolina makes the most sense there.
Yeah.
If he is traded, I guess, where do you play unknown goaltender number one? Same thing?
Yeah, like if, say, he's traded between now and the Tampa Bay game, I would expect Vladar to get the starts through the Florida game, and then insert goalie B, whether that's Wolf or Vanacek or Talbot or, you know, whomever.
If Markstrom gets dealt, it won't be until the 8th. I think that would happen right on deadline day. And in that case, I could even see potentially playing Vladar in both games in the back-to-back.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be just
depending
interesting.
On where the other guy is, if we can get him here that quick, if we can get him actually down to, you know, the East Coast that quick.
Oh, yeah. You might see Wolf get recalled for, you know, just get your stuff out there for the couple of days and then come back and
be yeah, I wouldn't even again. Be surprised if the Flames end up just taking Wolf on the trip.
Yeah.
Instead of trying to race him, you know, across the continent from Calgary, I wouldn't be surprised if they were to just call him up on the trip, because after the deadline, it doesn't matter. You can carry as many players as you want to as long as you're under the cap. So even if they technically don't bring him on the trip, but have them, you know, have them join him on the 9th.
Yeah, it's one of those that in order for him to be eligible for the playoffs in the A, he has to be down in the A. But they could, on deadline day, you're allowed to paper transaction people down. And we've seen that in the past where, like, a young guy might be up here, like, say, what Zari is now, and, like, get papered
down. Which is
too
bad they're not at home, because making a transaction from one dressing room to the other becomes a lot simpler.
Yeah. Instead,
just play the hokey pokey. Put your whole bag in, put your whole bag out, put your whole bag
well,
in.
Well, at least it's not like how it used to be where you'd have to fly the guy all the way, you know. So,
you had to tag up,
you're all the way in Tampa Bay. Now fly all the way back to Calgary.
And I want to know how they track that. Like, did you have to take a selfie of you at the airport? Or
yeah, you basically do, yeah.
Wow.
You have to actually log in that you're in the building where you're supposed to be, and then you have to go back to the airport and, you know, fly all the way back.
So in the deepfake era, that would be easy to fix.
So your mission is, you know, put a Dustin Wolf face mask on and, you know, just
you could even, I mean, at this point, just have a bunch of guys waiting outside the airport, walk in and walk back out.
Yep.
But yeah, I could see. And I think the rule is they have to be there at deadline, right? Which is 1 p.m. Calgary.
Yeah. And that's where the like a lot of paper transactions happen.
But even if they don't paper transaction, I mean, even if they had Wolf, you know, OK, it's 1 p.m. You're technically in Calgary. Now you're getting on a plane at 2 to join this road trip.
Yeah. Oh, no. And it's one of those where, like, the Flames were only allowed 4 recalls, so they'd have to burn one on Wolf at that point in order to bring
him up.
That's
true. Yeah, I forgot about the 4 recalls.
Yeah. So, like, you'll probably see Peltier and Zari both getting optioned to the Wranglers.
Yeah.
And then immediately recalled for that.
Yeah, I think Hunt will probably get sent down to...
Yeah. Yeah. And you might see Hunt just stay down there
at Rooney. That point.
Yeah. And that's where I could see guys just getting traded off, like Rooney, and just not replace him with anything. Because, like, I'm assuming that you're going to get, like, a forward back for Hanifin or Markstrom. So, you know, you could kind of work deals around where you can take that player if you need to. And,
it'll be an interesting week. We will record next Sunday, so a few days after the trade deadline, which gives us time to digest and think about what's happened. Obviously, we'll be on social media. You can find us on Twitter, X, at Fireside Podcast, Facebook.com/Fireside Chat.
And rambling on the Flames subreddit and Calgary.
There you go. Yeah, on Reddit, we're there. Anywhere, if you go to firesidechat.ca, look at the top of the page, you'll see all our social media links from there. Find us. We will be talking about deadline stuff on the deadline, the day after the deadline, but you'll be able to hear. We'll record next Sunday, and we'll put it out on Monday, as always. So we will come to you a couple days after the deadline with whatever moves happen. But, Matt, this is always an exciting week for Flames fans, and I feel like, you know, we've been slowly trickling things out, but I think this could be a very exciting deadline.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, especially like when you're either adding a lot or you're selling off, it's always a fascinating day. And the Flames are in seller mode, so, you know, it's more fascinating because you get to be excited. Oh, well, who's the guys that we're getting, you know, and how will they figure into the future of the team and, you know, then looking ahead to the draft when, you know, like the Flames hopefully will have 3 first-round picks and, you know, be able to actually have a proper draft show like we used to. When we used to have multiple picks. Well, and
don't get too excited for the draft yet. Let's get through deadline day.
Oh, I know. Well, those are the two fun parts of a rebuilding team is the deadline and then the draft afterwards. So, you know, and I do have to commend Conroy for his efforts this season. Like, he's put in a very impossible year to deal with all of that.
Tough but year the to amount be a rookie of GM.
You know, the amount of prospects and players that he's been able to add to this team, given the situation he had, I think he's done a masterful job of filling out a lot of the Flames farm system and then getting draft picks as well to help further fill out various holes with whichever players are available at those picks. And so it's just a good thing to see. You know, for doing a retool / rebuild, like, you know, you can't really have asked for much more than what he's done.
Well, let's see what happens this week before we make it sound like this chapter's closed. We will we'll go forward. We'll see what he does this week, and Matt, you and I'll talk about that next week.
Yep. And as always, go Flames, go.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.